Welcome to a very important episode of the Ultimate Guild Wars 2 Beginner's Guide, the one concerning the combat system. Guild Wars 2's combat system is significantly different from other similar titles. It is usually described as a hybrid of action and tab-targeted combat. This means that most of your abilities will be area of effect and need to be manually aimed or positioned. And almost every skill doesn't just affect the target you have selected and will cleave multiple enemies you hit. Some abilities, however, are single target and function very similarly to other massively multiplayer online games. You can see how many targets something can affect by looking over the tooltip for an ability. Ranged attacks often have a projectile element of some kind, which can be dodged simply by moving away from the target zone. And even attacks fired directly at the target can be sidestepped if the projectile is slow enough and the attacker is at a distance. The age-old tactic of standing behind something to hide is also highly effective. Projectile abilities will not hit you if you duck behind line of sight in time, even if they were cast before you did so. However, many area attacks don't require full line of sight, and you can still hit targets slightly around a corner. You can even hit through walls to a certain extent. Now that's impressive. Before we get to the main meat of the combat system, I want to briefly mention underwater combat. Underwater combat is slightly different to regular combat, as you're floating around in 3D space, but it's fundamentally the same. The thing to watch out for is that you have special underwater weapons that will change your weapon skills while underwater, and some abilities work a bit differently because of the different environment. A lot of abilities that are aimed on land will just cast directly on your target instead. Submerged battles are fairly uncommon these days in Guild Wars 2, and generally characters are a fair bit weaker when immersed in water than on land, so be mindful of that when engaging foes. If an enemy is in water and you are not, you'll probably have a significant advantage until they're able to get out. When it's time to annihilate those who stand before you, there are two main approaches you can take: direct damage and conditioned damage. Direct damage is dealt immediately. If you hit someone with a skill, they take all the damage immediately. This type can also critically hit for even more devastation. Conditioned damage is damage over time. Inflicting a damaging condition on an opponent will make them take damage every second for the duration of the condition. This type of damage cannot critically hit, but attacks that inflict conditions usually have a small direct damage component as well. Both of these damage types have their advantages and disadvantages. Direct damage is very useful to burst down targets quickly, while conditioned damage generally slowly stacks up and overwhelms targets, exhausting their ability to handle them over time. But conditions can be cleansed, negating their effect before they've had time to do their insidious work. Conditions also have other uses outside of damage. They can have debilitating effects on foes, such as increasing incoming damage, reducing healing, reducing movement speed, and even inducing the urge to run away in terror. Because of that, even if you choose a direct damage strategy, you'll probably end up using some conditions in your arsenal anyway, because of the truly disgusting effects they can have on your opponents, giving them a much harder time at surviving your onslaught. The positive counterpart to conditions are boons. These are both insanely important and powerful. Pretty much everything conditions do, boons can do the opposite. Increasing damage, reducing incoming damage, increasing cast speed, regenerating health, making you totally immune to getting stunned, or even temporary immunity to conditions. Boons are essential to being effective in Guild Wars 2, and almost every type of character you could possibly play will want to take advantage of them. This is particularly apparent when fighting monsters. When in a large group of players battling bosses, it's possible to work together and stack more or less every boon in the game to maximum levels. You'll really want to do this, as you'll end up being easily twice as effective, if not more. Just like conditions, boons can be removed. And while not every class has boon removal in its toolkit, it's a very powerful effect that is highly valued, particularly in competitive game modes, as boons are often a key part in the offense and defense of players. There's a lot more to talk about with regards to boons and conditions specifically, so they get a video of their own, which is linked in the description so I don't go on forever here. Right now, we just need to understand what these things are in the broad sense, but I'd highly recommend getting the juicy details, as having an intricate understanding of both will make your gameplay experience much smoother. There are a bunch of effects that don't fall into the category of condition or boon, and often have a unique effect like causing your next attack to turn an enemy to stone, set them on fire, increase damage by 5%, or adding some bonus stats. If you see an effect on you or another character, you can mouse over the icon to see its name and what it does. If you want to see what profession or monster applied the effect, use the /wiki command in chat to find it. Another great way to learn about other professions if you come up against something you don't recognize is to create a new character of that profession, then hop into PvP. You'll immediately have access to every skill and weapon without having to level up or anything, so you can just try it out, understand it, and then beat it. Or if you can't beat them, join them. A large distinction Guild Wars 2 has is how movement-based the game is, particularly in competitive modes. Almost all abilities can be used while moving, and in fact, if you don't use this to your advantage, your effectiveness in battle will be limited. Moving away from enemies' attacks while in return hitting them is a massive part of the game. Speaking of movement, one of the first things you'll probably notice is that you move slower while in combat, moving up slopes, moving side to side, and while backpedaling. So keep this in mind while fighting, as hindering your mobility can spell disaster. But you can also use this to your advantage, of course, as your opponents in player versus player will also have these same restrictions. A nice bonus meme, and one I'll get into more in another video along with some other settings tips, is about facing. You can bind a key to about face to make your character immediately turn around, and if you hold left click, hold your camera still as well. This lets you quickly change direction without backpedaling or disorientating yourself, which can give you an extra edge in the battle of movement and positioning. Additionally, there are a lot of abilities and effects in the game that have mobility baked into them, and can therefore be used for combat purposes and simply moving about the place. Traversing the area and being where you need to be is important, so you'll definitely be using this sort of thing. Guild Wars 2 also has no global cooldown, meaning you are only limited by the animations of your abilities, so the game ends up being pretty fast-paced, especially as most abilities have fairly short activation times. This means it's very important to always be doing something. It turns out that one of the best pieces of advice that can be given regarding combat in Guild Wars 2 is press your buttons vaguely in the right order with haste, and you'll probably be okay. Of course, that only works up to a certain point, and it's much better to actually know what you're doing. But you'd be amazed how many players are hindered by just doing nothing and twiddling their thumbs. Based on statistics from ArenaNet, skilled players do up to 10 times more damage in raids than the average player, and this sort of thing is completely true in the competitive modes as well. Your skill level and understanding of Guild Wars 2 will be by far the most important factor in your effectiveness, not gearing, not character progression, especially in player versus player where gear is completely normalized even from level 1. We were just talking about spamming abilities, so this is a good time to mention auto-attacks. Every weapon has an auto-attack. It's the first ability on its bar and has no cooldown. It's essentially your filler ability in between others. Some auto-attacks, typically on melee weapons, have what's called a chain, which means that consecutive uses of the auto-attack within a short time frame will cast different abilities which almost always increase in strength through the chain. If more than a few seconds pass between auto-attacks, then the chain resets back to the beginning. The final skill in a chain is usually significantly stronger than the previous ones, dealing more damage or having additional effects. Because of this, finishing your auto-attack chain is very rewarding, especially with certain weapons. It's not always possible in player versus player, of course, but when fighting monsters you almost always can, and finishing your auto-attack chains and weaving them into your damage rotation is an impactful skill to have as a player in raids, fractals, or dungeons. Almost every ability from players and monsters has a unique animation, which allows you to react to it by observing your opponent. Places where you probably shouldn't be standing are marked as well. Orange shapes indicate something bad is about to happen, and red wiggly lines indicate somewhere that is currently dangerous, and will have a negative effect on you if you stand there. The red lines in question can be a bit tricky to see at first, and in a lot of modern Guild Wars 2 content, the telegraphing is better for important areas of doom. Looking at what your enemies are doing and reacting accordingly is the key to success in Tyria, so keep an eye out for telegraphs. The game generally does do a pretty good job of explaining what you're supposed to be doing visually, but it can definitely take some getting used to, as Guild Wars 2 tends to be, shall we say, optically busy. You know what is great? Evasion frames. Characters in Guild Wars 2 can perform dodge rolls, and will avoid all attacks for a brief duration while rolling directionally. However, any conditions, damage over time effects, or similar afflictions will continue to damage you. You'll also still collide with barriers placed by enemies or players, and that will interrupt your dodge, causing you to stumble, so be careful where you dodge. Characters have a baseline of 2 dodge rolls stored up in 2 bars of 50 endurance each, with each dodge using up 1 endurance bar. Endurance regenerates at a base rate of 5 per second. In other words, you get a dodge every 10 seconds. Although this can be modified by certain effects in the game, which, as you might imagine, a very powerful thing to do. Your character will dodge in whatever direction you're currently moving, or backwards by default, so make sure you are pointing in the right direction, or you might accidentally jump off a cliff to your untimely demise. You can dodge at pretty much any time except while in the air, immobilized, or while a victim of some kind of stun or other control effect. Make sure your dodge key is one you can reach easily, because if you don't use this mechanic, well, your hero's journey will be a short one. Dodging, as you might have guessed by now, is the most important part of your character's survival everywhere in the world, and can save you from almost anything. A few attacks are undodgeable, but these are usually relegated to special moves of powerful monsters and bosses. Speaking of moving and dodging, another way to stay out of harm's way and gain an advantage is through terrain. Positioning is pivotal in Guild Wars 2, particularly in player versus player combat. If your enemy can't get to you or get a clear shot, then you are safe, at least for a while, allowing your abilities, endurance, and even health to recharge. You might also simply be able to attack your foe and they can't do anything about it. This exploitation of terrain is called kiting, and it's absolutely essential to your success in structured player versus player in particular. Without it, you simply will not be able to win against competent players, so getting used to abusing terrain to enhance your survivability and aggressive potential is paramount to victory. The power of positioning and the area of effect nature of almost every ability means that the combat system strongly promotes coordinating with your allies. Being in close proximity to each other will allow you to not only support each other, but also shove away enemies. You'll often see players stacking up to better heal and support everyone in both the open world, raids, dungeons, and world versus world. You won't typically see teams stacking up on top of each other too much in structured player versus player, but similar principles apply. Many a battle has been doomed after allies are isolated from their team and eliminated. United we stand, divided we fall. To assist with positioning, Guild Wars 2 characters have a special power that still confuses Guild Wars 1 players to this very day. Jumping. It's very likely that you have heard of this fabled skill, and it is quite important in Guild Wars 2. Not only can certain monster abilities such as shockwaves be jumped over, it's also key to moving around the game world. So much so that there are actually loads of really fun adventures in the world centered around jumping, aptly named Jumping Puzzles or JPs. These are a great place to get used to leaping all over the place while exploring some cool environments. When in a bad situation, consider where you might be able to climb to get out of harm's way. This is particularly relevant in structured player versus player, and the maps all have terrain set up exactly for this. There are some quite sneaky ones, and incorporating them into your gameplay massively increases your ability to escape and survive. Some of them do require the usage of movement skills or the usage of an interesting side effect of Guild Wars 2 mechanics called dodge jumping. Jumping and dodging at the exact same time will combine the two actions. This is very useful in some situations because not only does it allow you to jump slightly further than usual, it also allows you to do so even while slowed down by combat or movement impairing effects, because the movement attached to a dodge is not affected by any of those. The dodge jump trick is a bit of an advanced game mechanic and can take a while to get the hang of, so don't worry about it too much when starting playing, but I thought it would be worth mentioning as it is a useful trick to have up your sleeve. Something you are sure to encounter in the game sooner rather than later is being hit by control effects. Control effects temporarily prevent you from controlling your character in some way, because they're busy being stunned, knocked about, or simply running away in sheer terror. As you can imagine, this is quite inconvenient. Fortunately, there are ways around it. If you are currently empowered with the stability boon, then instead of getting shut down, you'll lose a stack of stability instead. And if it's too late for that, then many skills have a special effect called Stun Break, which you can see on ability tooltips. Using one of these will instantly get your character back up and running. They often have quite long recharge times, so use them wisely. It's always good to have at least one stun break in your toolkit, especially in competitive game modes, to get out of sticky situations. If you are struck by a control effect while casting an ability, you'll be interrupted, and whatever skill you are using will go on a 4-second cooldown instead of being available immediately. Auto attacks don't suffer this penalty, instead being set back to the start of their chain if they have one, but channeled abilities, abilities that do something while you're casting rather than after you finish casting, are the opposite, and will go on full cooldown if interrupted. Certain professions also have additional effects that they can apply to targets unlucky enough to fall victim to interruption. Interruption is a vital part of counterplay in player versus player, and getting a clutch interrupt can often be brutally punishing for your enemies, and of course, yourself. Playing reactively and understanding what abilities your opponents have, what their animations are, and when they're likely to use them, for example, healing when they're low on health, is essential for achieving victory. But what if you want to interrupt yourself? You might ask why you might want to do that, but there is actually a very good reason to do so. By stowing your weapon, which you need to assign a key to, you can cancel most abilities, putting them on a 4-second cooldown instead of their normal one. You can use this to bait out dodges, attacks, or interrupts from your opponent and avoid wasting powerful abilities on evading foes. Skill cancelling is the domain of mind games and montages. If you aren't spamming your stow-unstow keybind, then you are legally not allowed to make a Guild Wars 2 montage. Just like dodge jumping though, this is certainly a more advanced technique, so don't worry about it early on, but it is highly relevant, to the point where it can swing fights and even dictate certain 1v1 matchups in high-level play, and it will be used against you. Bear in mind that the same rule regarding channeling abilities applies here. If you weapon stow a channeled skill, it will go on full cooldown. Of course, control effects are not just useful in fighting other players, and most monsters are susceptible to control effects, but some are simply too powerful to fall victim to them. Occasionally, though, these monsters might grow a secondary light blue health bar called a break bar. If you see that, then unleash your control effects. The longer the effect, the more damage you'll do to the bar. When the break bar is drained, a few things can happen. Some monsters will be stunned for a few seconds and take massively increased damage for the duration, while others might just have their current action interrupted, allowing players to move on to the next stage of the encounter or preventing a lethal attack that the monster was charging up from destroying everyone. No matter what, breaking break bars is very, very important. So much so that it might actually warrant yet another video of its own. Using control effects to your advantage can either seal the fate of your targets or shut down your enemy's offensive completely. Use these versatile abilities wisely. The same goes for stability and stun breaks, though. With enough of those, you can become an unstoppable whirlwind of destruction. In both cases, coordinating with your team to maximize your effectiveness and line up combos is vital to success. Speaking of combos, Guild Wars 2 has a combo system. it's split into two parts, fields and finishers. Many abilities place down combo fields. Using them will create a temporary zone on the ground that enables abilities marked as combo finishers to have additional effects when used within the combo field. Combo fields usually come with a distinctive effect on the ground depending on the field type, so you can identify them visually and be ready to utilize them. Combo finishers come in four flavors: blasts, whirls, leaps, and projectiles. These are fairly self-explanatory. Blasts produce some kind of area of effect from within the combo fields. Whirls cause projectiles to be thrown out in all directions when used in a combo field. Skills that are marked as leap finishers produce an effect while used through a combo field. And finally, projectile finishers are enhanced when shot through a combo field. I won't go over every permutation of combos here, but as a rough guide, here's what you can expect from all the combo fields. Dark field combos are all about blind and lifesteal. Ethereal field combos apply chaotic defenses and confusion. Fire fields produce might and burning when utilized. Light fields help in removing conditions when comboed through. Ice fields chill opponents or shield you in frost in conjunction with finishes. Poison combos weaken enemies and, unsurprisingly, poison foes as well. Lightning field combos apply vulnerability days and swiftness. Smoke fields can be used to apply stealth or blind enemies. And water fields are all about healing and regeneration when used with finishes. The wiki has a great page that's linked below explaining every combo, so be sure to check it out to sate your curiosity. A video about combos will also be made in this video series as well, as it's one of the more underutilized systems in Guild Wars 2. Combos, in addition to adding some great flavor and roleplay factor, can be quite powerful. Some are certainly more powerful than others, but all of them have their uses, and knowing which combo finishes and fields you have access to can definitely give you an edge. Remember, you won't be able to create every combo field, but other players can, so it adds yet another layer of coordination in teamplay. For example, a thief could put down a smoke field, then other players could assist the thief in blasting it to stealth the entire team. Or a necromancer could cover the ground in a terrifying dark field that a ranger could fire life-leeching arrows through. The teamwork possibilities, while not endless, are certainly expansive. Certain classes utilize combos more than others, and can even have them as an integral part of their gameplay. For example, holosmiths in player versus player can generate a large amount of their sustain from water fields, and thieves often leap through smoke fields to sneak into invisibility. Combos have a visual effect when activated as well, so you can watch out for them like that. When you trigger a combo, you'll receive an indicator on your screen letting you know what combo you produced. Be careful when placing fields though, as you cannot overwrite combo fields by placing them on top of others. Only the oldest field will be activated if you use a finisher in two or more fields. Don't worry about that too much though. Overlapping fields is inevitable sometimes, and unless you specifically need a certain combo, it doesn't matter. There's one more thing to talk about now. I know it might sound absurd, but sometimes you may end up on the wrong side of a battle. In Guild Wars 2, you don't die instantly when your hit points reach zero, but instead enter the down state. When downed, you can't move, don't have access to your normal abilities, and your down state health bar slowly depletes. When emptied, you will become defeated with no chance of recovery. Each profession has a set of downed abilities to make their final stand, but they are not as powerful as normal, and you'll need some assistance to get back on your feet. If you manage to finish off your target somehow, or if an ally does it for you, you'll rally and go back to normal at 25% health. Your allies can also simply revive you to 50% health by moving to your body and pressing the interact key, which defaults to F. The other side of this is that in competitive game modes, you can finish off down players by also pressing F. You'll be locked in place and a long 3.5 second animation will start playing, and afterwards, the victim will be terminated for good. Or at least until they respawn. Reviving and finishing off players is one of the most important parts of the combat system in every game mode. One way or another, it should be one of your top priorities. Quick revival can completely swing a fight, and the same is true for a timely finishing move, or stomp, as it's often referred to. Note that you can simply damage a down state target to get them to the defeated state, and deciding whether to cleave down an enemy player or going for the finish is a tough and often highly impactful decision, one dictated by multiple variables, including how many enemy and allied players are around, if you have any downed allies, and whether you have stability or some kind of invulnerability available. Maybe it would be a better choice to simply use sheer force to destroy the floundering foes, or revive your fallen comrades. That's it. You now have the knowledge to master the Guild Wars 2 combat system and crush all those who stand in your way. It might sound really complicated, but I assure you that it's easy to learn and quite intuitive, yet deliciously hard to master. But because of that, Guild Wars 2 has some of the most engaging and rewarding combat out there. And seeing as the game is all about fighting stuff, that makes for a good time. Having the optimal Guild Wars 2 experience requires a solid understanding of the combat system, and learning about the game will greatly enhance your time in Tyria, and provides the true progression in the game, not of gearing and level, but of skill. Surely the greatest and most fun journey of them all. Thanks for watching. This video is part of a greater series that will cover the world of Guild Wars 2 and everything in it. Get subscribed and check out the playlist to see the other videos. If you have any immediate burning questions, leave a comment and I'll do my best to answer. I also stream nearly every day, so you can follow there and hop on to ask any further queries you might have, and have a look at the game while you're at it. If you are new to Guild Wars 2 or looking to grab the game, then if you want to support the channel, you can use my insane ArenaNet shill sellout link below to buy the game, and that'll do just that. That's all for now. I'll see you next time.